Yes. David called this morning at 7 o'clock saying he tested positive for COVID. So we're going to just wing it today. Two other people we need to be praying for. One is Carla Sherman, who just had knee surgery on Monday, and Scott Sherman, who has a cancer of the bone marrow, and I'm not sure what kind or exactly what they're doing yet, but Carla got home Thursday and everything's going according to plan, and Scott is being really good to her and taking good care of her, so that's what she said. Any other announcements? The council meeting after worship today. I turned on the air conditioning in the office, so it should be comfortable. I guess we're ready to begin.
Thank you.
nourish us with your word, that empowered by your spirit, we may love one another and the world you have made. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Thank you.
my word, and my Father will love them, and we will come to them and make our home with them. Whoever does not love me does not keep my words, and the word that you hear is not mine, but is from the Father who sent me. I have said these things to you while I am still with you, but the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. You hear me say to you, I am going away, and I am coming to you. If you loved me, you would rejoice that I am going to the Father, because the Father is greater than I. And now I have told you this before it occurs, so that when it does occur, you may believe. The gospel ends here.
Praise to you, Christ.
Our three lessons today are all about visions. And visions are kind of a wonky thing. You never quite know what it's all about. So Paul gets this vision of where he's supposed to go and what he's supposed to do. And then John in Revelation has a vision of what the world will be like when Christ comes again. And then Jesus, sitting with his disciples, tries to explain to them what their lives will be like when he returns to heaven. So the first rule of visions is that God is involved. And the second rule is that people are involved. So all three of our lessons have true visions. But how do we know when we have visions? I hear a lot lately from people that God said this, or God said that, God told me to do something, God saved a parking place for me, God led me somewhere. And I never quite know whether to believe them, because I'm not sure if it was God, or if it was their ego, or if it was something the world told them to believe. And for the most part, I don't get to sit down and talk about that. Now, during my day job, when I'm doing spiritual direction, I can talk with people about that. And we can kind of pull it apart and notice where God is working and notice what we're being called to. So the third rule of visions is that it includes love. That gets talked a lot about today too, because everybody loves everybody, or at least they all think they ought to. And don't ever say to somebody, well, you aren't a loving person, because they'd be really offended. But what does that look like? What is love really when you get down to it? Is it, you know, Hallmark cards, or nice words, or is it something you do for somebody? What is love about? I think there was a song like that. So here's the definition. Love is doing the very best thing that you can possibly do for your neighbor in the concrete circumstances. So it's not about what you want to do, or your thoughts and prayers, or your ideas. It's about concrete action. And it's what you can do, not what your neighbor can do. And it's what's really needed in the moment. So when God tells us to love each other, when he sends Paul out with the good news that God loves us and we are to love each other, or when Jesus sits down and says, follow my commandment, do what I tell you, what are they saying? Now, it would not be a good thing for me to lovingly say, oh, I'll keep the church books. I know how to add and subtract, because trust me, I don't. So that is not loving, although somebody needs to do that. And hopefully somebody will lovingly do that. It wouldn't help if I said, well, I'll make all the food for the potluck supper. First of all, I don't cook. I heat and eat. And then that would take away the joy of all the different kinds of things we get to eat when we come together. So sometimes the most loving thing is allowing somebody else to do something. Sometimes the most loving thing is doing it. And that's the hard part about loving, because we have to figure it out every time. In every moment, we can ask the question, what's the most loving thing here? Now, I've heard a lot of pastors complaining over the last couple years that their congregations don't want to listen to the gospel, because congregations have said the gospel is political. Jesus says, feed my sheep. Does that mean the sheep out in the field? No, that means all of us. And so when we say, feed my people, is that some political construct of liberalism or conservatism or something? No, it is the gospel. We're called to feed. We're called to heal. We're called to love, no matter what. And so when these pastors come into their churches and their churches are like, oh, well, pastor, I don't know, that's just a little bit too far out there for me. The pastors aren't understanding that it's concrete. It's what we can do, what you can do. Do we go the extra mile? Do we take extra food? Do we buy extra clothes when we're at the dollar store? Yeah, but that's because we can do it. And thank God that we can do it. When we go to auctions and things, it doesn't seem to me like there's much problem with the economy, because people pay a lot of money for stuff that I wouldn't even look at. It's probably valuable, but it's a lot of money. And so I think, what's wrong with the economy and all these people can spend all this money? And then I go into Safe Harbor, or I go to Carlisle Cares. And I met a man at Carlisle Cares when I was dropping off some clothes. And he said, do you have socks in there? I don't have any socks. And his gym shoes were all beat up. And the kids would call them Bobos, because they're just
chunky gym shoes. I don't know how old they were, but he had no socks. So can I buy him socks? I can. And I do. So during this week, while you are in prayer each day, whether you do that morning or night, doesn't matter, God's awake all the time, ask God, put in front of me what you would have me do. What is it, God, that I should do to show your love in this world? We hear a lot of negativity on the news. People are angry. People feel left out. People are afraid. But we have a source that can tell us how to love other people. And so when I do spiritual direction, I always give homework. And I'm giving you homework. Each day, sometime during the day, ask, God, how can I show your love in this world? Amen.
Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all living. set free from captivity to sin and death, we pray to the God of resurrection, to the church, people in need, and all of creation. God of new life, open your church to the unexpected ways your Spirit is at work. Guide bishops, pastors, deacons, and lay leaders in their visioning, partnership, and planning. Surround us with your peace. God, in your mercy, give a vision of increase and abundant harvest for farmers, laborers, and gardeners who are beginning their growing season. Join their efforts with the goodness of creation to feed all living things. God, in your mercy, shine your light of wisdom and peace among nations. Let those in power seek to assert dominance over others, confound their ways, and make them yield to your humble authority. God, in your mercy, give safe haven to those who seek healing, liberation, or peace. Create places filled with hospitality where hurting people find your loving presence and wholeness. God, in your mercy, uphold the works of ministries and organizations in our communities who assist people experiencing homelessness, citizens returning from prison, and all marginalized people, especially Safe Harbor and Carlisle Cares. Accomplish your will through their efforts. God, in your mercy, assemble your people at rivers, streams, and fonts where we remember our baptism and welcome others into the communion of saints. Gather us with those who have died when we meet together at your river of life. God, in your mercy, in your mercy, O God, respond to these prayers and renew us by your life-giving Spirit. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Share a socially distanced sign of peace.
Oh,
Praise to you for your Spirit poured out on all nations. As we pray each week, and as God is faithful to us, we respond and remember. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." With this bread and this cup, we remember our Lord's Passover from death into life, as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
O God of resurrection and new life, pour out your Holy Spirit on us and on these gifts of bread and wine. Bless this feast. Grace your table with your presence.
Come, Holy Spirit.
Reveal yourself to us in the breaking of bread. Raise us up as the body of Christ for the world. Breathe new life into us. Send us forth burning with justice, peace, and love.
Come, Holy Spirit.
With your holy ones of all times and all its creatures, with sun and moon and stars, we praise you, O God, blessed Trinity, now and forever.
Amen.
We pray in the words our Lord taught us.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Blood of Christ is given for you.
Peace.